the kind words. I start with a short summary of what I will be talking about. To start that off with an almost quote, friends, Roman numerals, countrymen, lend me your ears. I come to defend tech, not to praise it. One thing one has to note is that tech had a very hard childhood. It had a single father. It was talked to only in an artificial mother tongue that was stripped down from an original, already poor language called Pascal. And it never got to know dynamic allocation. It has actually no family or friends of its own age. It grew up. It's not the same age, and if you take a look at what the language is that Metafont is written in, it's the saner younger sibling, quite saner. And there actually was, when it was conceived, there was no computer science or even laws for computer science in that age. And it was a pathbreaker in itself in that it helped to create the art of computer programming or recreate it so that the message got out to the people about how to do computing. And now it's being judged by the culture that evolved around that which it originally created. And the question is whether that is a fair thing to do. Anyway, let's get to the basics. I had a talk several years ago where I talked about what would be desirable from a successor to tech that was more tractable for dealing with complicated problems in typesetting, like the problems I'll be talking about this afternoon, going into more detail in a case study, so to say. And I listed a few manageable problems, simple things such as box stretch, box fill stretch, box shrink. Those are invented names of mine, are just not available. If you have a typeset box which has stretch and shrink components in it, you can only ask for its natural size. You can't ask it how much shrink is there present. And if you do a typesetting task, if you try to do an optimization and say, okay, I want to place things on a page myself, and I want to know how good or bad it will look when it is on the page and whether something fits or it doesn't fit, you don't even have the measures available to get that information. You have these information are basically available in the output routine for the assembled page. Not even for the assembled page, actually, but for the material that tech has looked at when it made the choice of the page break decision. So if tech looked at 10 more lines before it decided, okay, this does not fit, so I'll break at an earlier point, the summary data that you have in the output routine is actually that where it looked and not where it decided to do the break. So there are just internal numbers that are missing which you need access to. Then we have, you can't deconstruct the bugs reliably. I mean, there are things like unpenalty, unkern, stuff like that, and taking the last box off it. But those primitives aren't there for everything. And if the last box was typeset with a shift left or right, you don't get the information that it had this shift. So you lose that information. If you had glue that was consisted of leaders, this information gets lost, and so on and so on. So, and there are things like Marx or Watsits or stuff like that, which you can't even get off the list. So that deconstructing list there just stops. And that's just talking about vertical lists. And horizontal lists, there are even more problems, since you can't even remove single characters. And if you were able to remove them, then anyway you would get into trouble with ligatures and similar things. So then we have variables that tech employs for decisions, and they are partly just not there. I mean, like, if you take a look at the total demerits that it has when doing paragraph breaking or stuff like that, it makes decisions and it doesn't tell you about them. In some cases, some of the results of those decisions were explicitly ruled out by Knut because he said he doesn't want to be able to guess from within tech how it did some rounding operations in the floating point arithmetic that is used in very few places in tech, actually. Then we have peculiarities when we are building lists, like the first line's baseline, if we do a VTOP box, is ruined if you start off your first line with a WATSIT, like a write statement or a mark or something like that. And it even gets lost if you do a V-split operation, which is the usual way to manually split a large box into smaller boxes, and then you get a top skip put at the top of the resulting box, and as a result the baseline of the first line is also lost. So the question is, how does LuaTech address these problems which I presented at that time? And we can say part of those problems are addressed. There are the mechanisms for solving many of those problems in place, because it has the list deconstruction stuff. It has the way to go through node lists and stuff like that. So there are ways to actually implement sort of tech macros which work with LuaTech and do this kind of job. Then we have the problem of the macro language. I mean, tech is not a programming language. It really isn't. It is it's a macro language, and it's thought for simple manipulations of text, and it breaks down when you go to more complicated things. Or rather, the programmer breaks down. So we have global register pools, which are a sparse resource traditionally. Now it's not so sparse anymore, even though it's implemented using sparse arrays. Those are, you have to work with, you have to allocate your registers, and then they're more or less gone. So that does not lend itself very well to fluid programming, and there are no lexically local variables. We have a system of locality that's based on groups, and groups change only in text stommage, and the macro structure is not actually accessible by, it does not work with the stomach, but works in text mouth. So that means that basically all programming tasks which you have to do using text mouth, because there you have conditionals, and you have the way to do tests, and you have the way to juggle with code that is executed, but you don't have the actual infrastructure for doing programming tasks, namely registers, values, assignments, counters, stuff like that. Even a simple loop already requires using the stomach again. So you have two subsystems which are in itself completely useless as a programming system, and which are then combined into one unholy chimera which transfers controls at strange moments and has lots and lots of side effects. And it's somewhat better with ETEC in that you have more ways to juggle around with tokens without involving the stomach, but basically it's you get better tools for shooting yourself in the foot. And one typical problem is that probably everybody has encountered is cat codes. And if you define macros and the macros take arguments like footnote macro and so, and there are cat code changes expected inside of this footnote, like if you do a verbatim environment or stuff like that, things just fall apart because the cat codes are already assigned. Tech does not process letters as such, but it only ways processes tokens, not characters. And that makes for a lot of mess because right when it starts seeing things, it turns them into a token and this choice stays. Again, ETEC has some mechanisms for shooting yourself in the foot faster, for accomplishing a similar thing, but they have their own problems as well. So implementing regular input languages is hard. I mean, a regular input language, this is a talk from a few years ago, and I don't know what I mean by that. Anyway, whatever a regular input language may be, if we take a look at what LuaTeX accomplishes in that area, then we have some issues that probably can be addressed, but if we address the things using Lua the solutions do not interact closely with tech regarding the data types and structures. Solving problems in Lua is different from solving problems in tech just because we have different data. I mean, a token list is something which is very natural in tech and which is sort of cumbersome and hard to juggle around with in Lua. You can do it, but you have to access every token and or work with it. It's the natural way of working with stuff in Lua would be using strings, where you don't assign cat codes and stuff like that. Anyway, then we have interoperation problems of tech with other applications. That's one thing. Tech only knows its own font formats, metrics, and ligatures. And it does not talk to graphic programs in any serious way. You use specials or basically include graphics or stuff like that, but it's nothing that's really inside of tech, even though PDF tech gets a bit more knowledge about PDF that it includes. Then most important, if the material is generated externally, then tech can't trigger reformatting of that material. If tech decides, okay, this image would be nicer if it would be scaled somewhat smaller, then it can't tell an external application, please render this at a different size or arrange it differently, or could you see whether I can get this with a different sized box with different ratios. There is no way to talk to external applications that produce the material to in order to let them generate stuff new. Okay, let's see what LuaTeX solves in that area. It has the basics for understanding open types, so one can access the stuff. One can probably not only open type, but also, I guess, other font formats as well. And it talks with the MetaPost library, and it can call through Lua external programs for regenerating stuff. So we have some more possibilities in that area, and LuaTeC addresses that nicely. Now we come to algorithmic problems concerning the core algorithms of tech. And one of the design features of tech basically is that there are some areas where Knuth, its author, decided, okay, I'm going to do the stuff perfect. He's defining the problem and he's defining a solution set, and he makes an algorithm that, for the problem definition, generates the optimal solution. And you can tweak anything with that, and as long as you are fine with the definition of the problem, you get along fine. If you want to define your problem differently, you have a problem. For example, the paragraph break optimization for tech works globally. That means it always reads an entire paragraph into memory and then chooses the breakpoint sequence of all possible breakpoint sequences that generates the optimum result according to penalties and demerits. And it's optimal in that area. The problem is, if you then go and take this paragraph and split it across pages, your optimality goes down the drains, because, for example, it decided to hyphenate at a point where the hyphenation was okay. I can hyphenate here and I can also leave off the hyphen. The results are equally well, or I can hyphenate in the line above instead and stuff like that. So it chooses the under the assumption, okay, this will no longer be split afterwards. It chooses the optimal breakpoint sequence. And then we have stuff like broken penalty, which tells tech how bad it is if a hyphen ends at the end of the page. The problem is, what does tech do with that information? It hits itself on the back and says, bad tech, but it does not re-break the paragraph differently. So you can find out afterwards how bad it was, but you can't change it. Yeah. Then tech has no sane concept for asynchronous user code. Output routines are asynchronous code in that they are called at times that are not controlled by the input, more or less, but are processed independently. It's a sort of a pipe paradigm. You have a pipe where pages are piped through, and whenever a complete page is full, then the reading end of the pipe starts code up and does a few decisions and then gives control back. So what you basically want is a writer-reader model and communication via message passing. It would be more or less the object-oriented topic of message passing. We don't have that in tech. Instead, the output routine is shielded with an additional grouping level and then is called one shot and finishes. And the problem is, you often have to do decisions in the output routine where you say, okay, I need more material before I make my final decision. And this get more material means that you have to completely exit the output routine and start a new one and stuff like that. And it gets very messy for programming. So, bad. Tech has no possibilities for making use of side effect free user defined code. I mean, this is somewhat off the head what I'm meaning here with speculative context is it would be nice if this paragraph optimization would, for example, throw out the five best candidates for paragraph breaking, and then we have to speculatively do several versions, and then afterwards we can pick out one from the best candidates according to other criteria, like is there a hyphen at the end of the page or stuff like that. So it would be nice to be able to either have a list of candidates which you carry around and don't have to control manually, or tech has a way to say, okay, this ended up badly, please restart and try if you can find something under the following constraints. So what does Lua take off on that area for opening up the inner algorithms of tech so that one can add additional criteria for global optimization, that one can open up the optimization engine? And there we have to say nothing. I mean, the coroutine concept might be interesting for using in the output routine. I'm not sure whether it would work. You would have to do it purely in Lua because, of course, you can't work with tech code in that manner. But I'm not sure how it will work with the native libraries and whether you can actually use this coroutine concept well in this. It would be interesting. But apart from that, we have to say that LuaTech does not meddle with the internals. It taps into a lot of places where you can more or less take a look at what passes through tech and change what passes through tech, but the manner of working, the algorithmic structure of tech is not changed. It's left as it is. Okay, then I have an example here for a task that was done using complicated mechanism, line numbering. I mean, if anybody of you looked at the line number style package and read its source code and is not yet in a mental institution, my congratulations. The line number style works by replacing all interline penalties with forced page breaks. So there's a page break after every line, and the output routine then takes the material that was broken after every line and reassembles the stuff afterwards after inserting the line numbers, and then reinserts the correct penalty. So basically the forced page breaks, it subtracts some large value from all interline penalties so that all penalties become large negative and force a page break, and afterwards adds the stuff up again. And you have to use a multi-pass mechanism that resets then the line numbers at the start of the page, because otherwise you can't do label referencing, stuff like that. So what would be a saner alternative? So now here I have designed some concepts, like I defined a concept of migration and boxes migrate from one list to another. You start off, for example, a horizontal list migrates into a vertical list. When elements move from one list into the other, then they trigger certain actions. That was some sort of object-oriented speculation about how things could be defined and how one could really say this element does this and that when you move it from there to there, and it does it under those constraints and with those penalties, and please make the best of that. So if we take a look at whether LuaTech would facilitate something like that. Maybe one could implement part of this concept in there, but it would be at a sort of a format level. So it's not in there automatically. Then other problems which are interesting to tackle are synchronized texts. Okay, with poetry, it's really easy. At first, that's what one thinks, and then one has the problem that some lines go in multiple lines, and so you need additional spacing in the parallel column in order to offset that. And if one takes a look at what happens here with this overflow line. It moves up because it would not fit otherwise. Usually it could be fit down there, but there's a line number, so the decision of where to move the stuff depends on whether the line above and below are short enough, whether they carry line numbers and stuff like that. It's pretty hard to do that in tech. Lua Tech has more possibilities to juggle around with material after it's already broken and prepared. This example I just skip because I'll be talking about it later today. And yeah, just as a real life example of what complicated typesetting task exists is here part of bilingual, it's the, what you call it, Evangelion. Okay. The gospel, right. The gospel according to John. And we have at the left side, we have the Latin version. We have at the right side, we have the Greek version. We see that we have verse numbers here. And we have lots of references, and they are arranged in a way that they fit the place. We have critical apparatus, which give information about the Latin Vulgata text and the Greek sources. We have here a lot of cross-references as well, and here's also critical apparatus formatted in a particular way with lots of information and partly a bit stuffed. Here it's quite close to the page number. One has to know that this particular edition has come out in about 10 or 12 different languages. And their typeset, you get usually the bilingual versions of this and thus, and one language is one set of plates. And that means that all the breaks, the page breaks, are in all the different languages are all at the same place. This was manually done, and it's an expensive process. Here on the inner margins, there are also references to some commentaries. So this kind of mess is not easy to do, and managing the complexity to a level where you can say, okay, a document designer can work with that and not a general purpose genius is still nothing that I see readily available right now. Okay, these are programming concepts I was talking about, but they are not that important, maybe. No, I basically mentioned that. So these designs were just speculative and don't measure much about what makes up context. Yeah, I was talking a bit about optimization. Global optimization leads to combinatorial explosion of runtime if you have decisions like page breaking, which the results of paragraph breaking are easy to visualize. Page breaking is much more complicated because the output routine does much more than just create fixed pages, but it can do lots of separate things. And so it would be interesting to say, okay, I can run this output routine 5 times on different sets of data, and the runs are basically independent, and I get to pick the best run much later. And of course, running it 5 times the page through and running the output routine 5 pages times through means quite more work. And so one has to see how one can optimize the work and do reuse of part of the work and factor out that work which can't be reused and just repeat that and stuff like that. I don't see a path in LuaTech right now, but it may be a problem of the format to define proper hooks. So, disadvantages of tech, well, I talked about it being disadvantaged in the beginning. Disadvantages of this, it's disadvantages of the model I presented there. One needs more memory, which given the memory uses of context and so on is a no-brainer, because we already waste lots of tech of memory because we're implementing algorithms in tech. Backtracking causes higher computational resources, and you get more potential for things that run on eternally or virtually eternally. And the question is, if I have a platform like that, would I want to produce TripTech compatible tech running there, and TripTest compatible tech? And the question is, where's the point? Why would I want to go for worse typesetting when I can get better one? And I don't see 10 minutes. Yeah, okay. So concepts don't. I don't see a relevant path into the sort of getting the flexibility needed for doing good decisions in a more global optimization frame for certain tasks. So here I was talking about an implementation language where one would implement these concepts and making demands for it. It should offer a natural expressivity for lists, tech typical strings and token lists. The required mechanisms should be natively available within the language. It should have automatic garbage collection, of course. It need not be a single layer. Instead of the tech Pascal, tech macro layering, one can use more layers in between. And I present some examples, of course, inspired by Emacs, which also is written mostly in Emacs Lisp, which is based on C. But the main language with which you work with Emacs is Emacs Lisp, even though some extensions have to be done in C. And it makes the whole thing much more tractable, believe it or not. And problematic things for the implementation language: coroutines would be nice to have. And here I was asking about Smalltalk and Ada. At that time, Lua was not yet a topic. IO is a separate theme. I'm not going into that right now. And one wants to have the possibility to do certain stuff inside in C. And one should allow for low-level implementation of fast algorithms on custom data structures. So we don't want unnecessary language features that bog down the stuff, like in Ruby or stuff like that. And if we take a look at this list of demands for implementation language, it is rather well matched by LuaTeX, with the exception of the natural expressivity for tech typical data structures. We don't have really that good ways to talk about tech in Lua that look still natural in Lua. So the data structures of tech are basically not something foreign to Lua, but Lua has a user data concept where it can basically work with binary blobs and have operations working on that. That's pretty flexible and certainly will help. Then we don't have a useful equivalent for tech's grouping structure inside of the Lua in LuaTeX. A useful equivalent is probably a bit of an oxymoron, because text grouping structure is is more like a burden than useful, but it isn't mapped to Lua. So then we have for cat-coded token lists, we have no really convenient and natural equivalent in Lua either. And I'm not yet sure. I have to do some experimentations to see how much it will be possible to work with coroutines in order to make algorithms that interact more naturally. So language features that Lua offers is lexical scope with closures. That means that the scope of variables is defined when you read a function in, when you read a block in, and outer blocks can have their values reused in inner blocks, and that holds for functions and stuff like that as well. So that's a very powerful concept, and I recommend everybody to take a look at programming in Lua. Older versions of this book are available on the net for printout. The newer, their most recent version is only available in HTML or from a book store. But the next two latest version of the book is really fine for learning the language concepts. Lua has coroutines, very simple, very cleanly, very elegantly done. They are synchronous and can pass values in both directions. So when one coroutine passes control to another one, it can pass values. It's a very powerful concept, and it's very useful for basically data processing, which happens in sort of a pipeline logically. The numeric data type is double float, so it comprises both 32-bit integers and 14.16 fixed point numbers. The tech numbers which we have can be represented exactly in Lua, and that's fine, because that means that Lua can work with the tech data without losing any precision that was available in tech. The other way around is a bit, making use of language features. That's the question. How can we embed Lua into our existing workflow? And there we see that the control structures of Lua are they form lexical units. That means if we have a loop, then this loop is front to bottom in Lua, and it can't execute any tech in between. It can only push things into a tech pipeline via tech.print, and then later gets tech gets to process that. So we have that means basically if we want to profit from the control structures of Lua in an application, it's necessary that the control structure is completely transferred from tech into Lua and done there, and tech is only used for the typesetting tasks but no longer for the control task. It may be that the coroutines offer some ways to juggle around with that, but in a way that a Lua control structure yields for a while, lets tech work, and then later resumes at that point of time. I still have to check out how well this interaction of tech and the coroutines will work. But basically, if you want to get the benefits, you have to turn your problem description inside out like a glove, and have then Lua on the other side, and make the control, transfer the complete control outside to Lua, and leave nothing for tech. So it's not a task that's easy to accomplish. Then we have the lexical scoping of Lua more or less means that we should not use the grouping structure of tech for control. When we use...
You still have 4 minutes left for everything including questions, so if you want to...
Ah, for everything including questions. Yeah. Okay, then I'll try to Yeah, well, I'm just at the important part of the summary. So I'm afraid there are not that many slides remaining. Anyway, so we again have the problem to transfer the algorithm. We have to more or less rip whatever has been implemented using purely tech methods and tech thinko completely out and replace it with our own set. There is no really good halfway in between. The data types don't correspond perfectly with tech data structures, but well, what's to be that's to be expected. Okay. Now the title was about tech for lions and for ants. Why is this so important? Because tech expertise is a sparse resource. And we don't want to drive to have the few tech experts that are still living drive them into early despair. And and tech programming requires already a lot of expertise, even for solving conceptually small tasks. Tech data structures are nothing that are not natural. And the text processing is bogged down with cat codes. We are always having cat code. I'm working in a large company, and cat code problems are occurring all the time. And the consequence would be move the complete data and program flow to Lua and use tech only for processing fragments.
Lua.
Yeah. And what does that mean for refactoring projects using Lua tech? It means that the best projects to do that are standalone applications, which don't even have much of, don't interface much with LaTeX or any format, but which are standalone. That's perfect. There you can do the reversal of control structure without without getting into more of a hell that's than is really needed. Format files like context is also one stuff. A complete format. You can refactor it completely and then have a consistent new format that basically has its control structures in Lua and just uses tech for the typesetting. So, two minutes,
make it one.
One, okay. Then the problem is what else can we do? Make it one. Okay, we have interface problems. The data structures are not matched. And program features. Okay, I talked about that. That's just a summary. And I give you 20 seconds to read that. I was just thinking we don't yet have an appropriate animal chosen for representing Lua, do we? But they're very robust. Okay, questions?
Yeah, I think it was a nice overview of what LuaTeX offers a programmer. I mean, someone like you in QueenScape or many other people around.
Yeah, but there's still quite a bit of road ahead in order to arrive at something where a document designer can hope to have a tool where he just needs to specify what he wants done and instead of how to do it. And
yes, yeah. Sure. But okay, that's what we have for the moment. You can, and I especially like the quote at the beginning. It's a nice thing that you do your slides at the last minute. So.
Wouldn't it be advantageous to break the behemoth called tech into a library and interact with the library using Glua? Or something like that.
It might be interesting. I mean,
not my idea. It's Chris Rowley's. I will distribute his ramblings about tech.
Yeah, I mean, it's done with MetaPost, and it would certainly be interesting. And one thing that I was also worried about is if you're doing programming in Lua tech now, that you have a mixture of tech programming and Lua programming, and stuff like editor support or readability or syntax highlighting and so on are very hard to do with this sort of mixtures. You basically can't have both. And if you transferred the tech functionality to a library and basically did no tech programming at all, but only tech typesetting, I think that would make for a much cleaner platform for solving problems. But one thing to realize is that re-implementing something like LaTeX in that manner is simply out. You have to start from scratch. Not even the plain text format would be useful for anything.
Okay, well, thank you.